Barbara Brenner.
Here.
Rud Browne.
Here.
Barry Buchanan.
Here.
Pete Kremen.
Here.
Ken Mann.
Here.
Satpal Sidhu.
Here.
Carl Weimer.
Here. Just a couple of quick announcements. If you have your cell phone, you want to put it on vibrate or silent, that would help us avoid listening to lots of strange music coming from weird places. Also, if you're handing out any paperwork during the public hearing or during the open session, if you can get a copy to our clerk up front, that is great for the record. And we're going to move right into our first public hearing, which is a... What's that? Oh, yeah, flag salute. If people will stand and join me in the flag salute before I get my patriotic self in trouble.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Now we'll move right into our first and only public hearing, which is a request for a major adjustment, a major amendment, and a one-year extension for the final approval of the Lincoln Road Long Subdivision. And do we need a staff report, or are people ready to go on this one? Ms. Brenner.
Well, we had it in committee, and it was a unanimous vote to recommend approval.
Okay. So seeing no need for a staff report, I will open the public hearing. It looks like a few people signed up, maybe for this, maybe for something else, but we'll work through these names, and anybody that wants to speak certainly can. The names on the list, there's only three. It's Cassandra Childs. I'm going to mess up because I'm having a hard time. I think it's Suzanne Alexander. Those are the two names on here. Did they mean to sign up for this hearing? All right, come on down. And as you come down, I'll give you the rules. Each person will get 3 minutes. When you come to the microphone, if your name is more complicated than Smith or Jones, if you can spell your last name for us, we will get it right in the record. And when you get about 30 seconds, the clerk will give you a warning how much time you have left.
All right, I'm Cassandra Childs. I'm a volunteer from the Bridget Collins Public Policy Education Committee, whose purpose is to improve safety and well-being of children by educating policymakers on issues pertinent to children and family and the best practices for
safety. Excuse me, this is a hearing on the Lincoln Road Long Subdivision.
Sorry.
Is that what you're here for?
It was just public.
Okay,
comment.
We're going to have an open public session as soon as this hearing's done, okay. Which ought to be in just a few minutes.
Sorry.
Thank you.
I'm Sean Alexander.
All right, Sean.
I represent Ice Blue LLC, and we are the adjacent neighbor to the Long Platte subdivision. We are just requesting that all the buffers be in place because this is a different land use or a different zone than what we are. We're forestry. We're next door. And in the past, we've had problems with people coming onto our property, depositing garbage and stuff. I believe it was in 2009 when this was first brought up. At that time, we asked for a fence or some kind of buffer, and we're just repeating that. We want to make sure that there's some distance between our forest land and this residential area. I haven't seen the plans. I got the notice a bit late, so I don't really have anything other than that to prepare for you. But what I'd like to say is that we just want to make sure that if there are buffers or any type of way to separate their land use from our land use, we'd like to see that enforced to the fullest extent, what the county's allowed to do. And I'm sure you've already examined everything because you've already agreed to vote on it. So, and.
All right, thank you. Ms. Brenner.
Well, we extended it. You might want to talk to Mark Personius sitting over there. He can direct you, if it's not him, who to talk to, because this is going to go through more of a process.
I appreciate that, and thank you very much for your time.
All right, is there anybody else that wants to speak to us about the Lincoln Road Long Subdivision? See no one, I'm going to close the public hearing. What are the wishes of the council?
I move approval.
So Mr. Mann has moved approval. Is there a second?
Second.
Mr. Kremen has seconded. Any other discussion?
Oops.
All right. I did close the public hearing. We've got a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? That passes unanimously. Now we're going to move on to our open public session where anybody can speak to us about whatever they want for 3 minutes. And it's kind of first come, first served. Same rules apply. When you get down to about 30 seconds, you'll get a warning that your time is about to run out. If your name's complicated, spell it for us. And whoever wants to start off.
Mr. Chair.
Yes.
If I may, I know this is the first night that since we've changed the council procedures. But my understanding is that items that have come from committee with approval don't require a second.
I don't know. The clerk told me earlier that just about anything that comes out of my mouth tonight is going to require a second.
Good evening. Am I supposed
to
just...
We'll talk about it when we get to that.
Okay, that's fine. Just try to make life easier.
Go ahead.
Good evening. My name is Cynthia Sue Ripke-Katsigowitz. And I live in Whatcom County. I want to thank you, sir, also, Mr. Sidhu, for coming to be so gracious to help our at our memorial service. And that's one of the reasons I'm here tonight. And here I have, and I'm going to leave extra information. I have an undergraduate in sociology from Sacred Heart University. So I'm going to speak from sociological standpoints on the need for a jail now. I have worked in five different departments of correction, from Garner in Newtown to Watsu in Newtown. So I'm going to show you, these are prisons and jails I've worked in, the sheriff's jails in Florida, and I've worked in seven different areas in psych. So right now, I am so grateful, I'm hoping it's correct that you are thinking of getting a jail, not only for people that need correction, but for our officers to be safe. So I'm going to speak to one issue tonight. I'm going to leave you these areas that I've worked in, and I'm hoping that you get a sociologist on board. Because in working in these areas, which can be very dangerous to all, the big thing I'm going to address tonight, this is, I keep up my RN license, the amount of, in Garner and in Florida, the amount of infection and things for both officers and inmates. There was one nurse. So, I mean, with other things, and yes, as a mental health nurse, I've worked in both capacities, trained very differently. There's also, accordingly, to be properly diagnosed, the officers have 300, for a particular crime that they go by to see, well, why are you in here? But the nurses, sadly to say, in your library system, someone took, stole, whatever, the nurse's DM-5. But I'm really hoping that you do realize the need for this in a safer area. And you do know that 27% of the inmates in Whatcom County are, you know, even not from this area. So I'm so glad that you're thinking that it's a societal problem that other people, everyone, should be helpful, responsible for. I drove around Whatcom. Already your property owners, they've got security and all kinds of things that they're trying to keep themselves safe. Today in the news, there were so many things going on in Canada. Two officers served a warrant, and they were shot. I mean, so this is a very dangerous profession, number one. I felt safe walking up to SAG, that's maximum security, because I had overwatch officers watching me. I could tell you lots of stories about
30
them.
Seconds, please.
Thank you. But I'm hoping with the materials I lift, not only that about the gangs, the 42 gangs in Whatcom County, that you really think seriously about the jail where it should be. Thank you very much, and I would be glad to offer any other information I can to all of you. Thank you.
Thank you. Go ahead, Bob. Mr. Seaman.
My name is Bob Seaman from Custer. Council members, thank you for your time, and most importantly, thank you for your public service. I come before you one last time to give you an update on my neighbor Beacon Battery and used tire. He's offered to purchase my home, which I'm accepting, but it wasn't the outcome that I had hoped for. The living conditions have become so unbearable there that I've been forced to sell my home because of the lack of code enforcement. This has gone on for 23 years. A year ago, I came to Jack Lyles in Planning and Development to report that all the conditions of the condition of use permit were being violated, along with many other violations. After 9 months of no action, and email exchanges with Sam Ryan and Ron Ewart thanking me for my patience, I filed a public disclosure request. And basically all I got from PDR were my same emails back from the county. I then went to King 5 News, Sam Ryan indicated the tire pile was out of compliance and the county was reopening the case. I thought the file was open since I filed a citizen's inquiry report last year. I don't know how they're reopening something that's supposed to be open. In the report, Sam Ryan indicated with three code enforcers, about 300 complaints per year, it was difficult to keep up. She simply needs more staff. She can't do the job. At the July 22, 2014 council meeting, Jack Lowes commented that the reason for the backlog of code enforcement was because citizens hire attorneys in their dealing with planning and development, and it slows down the system. Sadly, we have to hire attorneys. We have no choice. In Business Post magazine, Jack Lowes is quoted as saying, lean principles will be applied throughout county government. Any government that maintains a perpetual state of austerity, it fails the people, which is what's happening now with code enforcement. In closing, please hire sufficient code enforcement staff to keep other people from going through what I've had to go through. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Ms. Padil.
Good evening, Council. Marion Padil, south side of Bellingham, longtime resident in Whatcom County. Water. You all know that I work on water. Still ongoing because it hasn't been solved. I'm here specifically to call attention to a program that I'm putting on 2 days from now, Thursday night, for a public discussion, an open roundtable session, discussing the resource of water that we have in the county, especially in the North County, to the north side of the Nooksack River, and the distribution of that water, who has a technical term, I don't want to call a right to take the water, who has a justified position to take water that they need to use for domestic purposes, for agricultural purposes, irrigation systems, all kinds of industry and so forth. Each of you know, but the public doesn't very often know, the circumstance about taking water. The water in the state of Washington, hello people, belongs to the state of Washington until you ask for and are granted a permit to take some of it. Same analogy I use, if there are trees standing in a state forest, who do they belong to? Well, those trees belong to the state. Oh, hey, John, let's go in there and take our saw and go cut down a couple of trees and take them away and use them. No, you can't do that. Same rule for water. But over the years, because bless the whatever, we seem to have a lot of water available in this county, that hasn't been a big deal. People drill a well, take some water, et cetera, et cetera. However, if you watch the weather, if you watch the circumstances going on, it's getting worse and is going to get worse. And my mission on this right now, having worked with water systems management all of my professional career, is to let's bring some solutions up on the table, out in the public, educate the general public about the circumstances on water availability, water use, how do you do it, what are you supposed to do, what are you supposed to not do. So I'm calling a session for anybody who is interested, either with experience to speak or ask questions, or without experience, come to the meeting and learn what's the status, what's going to be our future for management of that precious resource,
30 seconds,
water,
please.
Out in the north side of the county. I'll footnote that the people in the city of Bellingham, bless you all, you've got water. You don't have this problem in this way because it comes from Lake Whatcom, which is a separate activity, water hydraulic activity. But out in the county, especially in the agricultural zone, I sense, having worked, like I say, in agricultural irrigation work for 30-some-odd years,
time.
We are poised for a big problem, and I'm trying to work with everybody to make sure it doesn't happen big. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Yoshi Ravel. Thank you to members of the audience and staff, members of the County Council, Mr. County Executive. We deal with a number of problems, both personal, from personal to local to national to international. things like climate change and abortion, war, greed, jail and justice issues, healthcare issues, so on and so forth. The interesting thing is they all have something in common. Every one of the things that I talked about has something in common, and that is fear. The primary cause of climate change is overconsumption driven by fear. Why do we abort our children and send our children off to war? Because we are afraid. Why do we lust after money? Because we are afraid. Why are there jail and justice problems? What is the primary cause of crime? The primary cause of crime is fear. The vast majority of our healthcare problems are driven by fear. Given that, what is the solution? We as adults have forgotten how to cry. We have forgotten that even as adults, it is necessary for us to release our pain and our fear through our tears. And if we don't release our pain and our fear through our tears, the result is insanity. We literally go crazy. We were given our tears for a reason. They help us to release our pain and our fear. The other thing, the other solution, kindness. We human beings are designed to be kind with each other. There are things called altruism genes. It's in our genetic makeup to be kind with each other. There are things called empathy centers in our brains. Emotion is our first language, not the speaking words, emotions. There are things called mirror neurons. We are so connected to each other, we absolutely do not realize how connected we are to each other. And kindness, deeds of kindness, are what will bring us healing and what will solve the major problems and will lead us towards a more just and peaceful world. I thank you all for your attention, and I wish you all a pleasant evening. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Dick Bosch of Glen Echo Garden. 8 years ago, my wife Jenny and I completed a 45-year dream to develop a botanical garden. We selected Bellingham as our location and established Glen Echo Garden. Today, we are known as one of the most beautiful botanical tourist attractions north of Seattle. As a result of a very unreasonable complaining neighbor, restrictions of the conditional use permit, particularly noise restrictions, as defined by hearing examiner Michael Bobbing, we have become so severely restricted that we may not be able to remain in business. When we applied for the conditional use permit, there were a good number of letters in support, but only one neighbor complained about the wedding music and light coming from our greenhouse. Without any investigation or measuring the sound level, Susanna Bossman sided with that neighbor and prepared a very negative staff report to the hearing examiner. And we were devastated with all of the restrictions. First of all, the amplified music was taken away. We were forced to appeal that ruling at a cost of $10,000 and lost more revenue the following years. We received 1 hour per wedding of amplified sound back. The remaining restrictions stayed. Number one, we are not allowed more than 20 people for small events. We are a tourist attraction, but may not accommodate a full 48-seat tour bus. That's not allowed. Number two, no one allowed in the garden after 5 p.m., including small family gatherings. Our business is so seasonal. We only get 4 months per year, June through September. This is a blatant discrimination. No other botanical garden, park, sports field is so restricted. The application that we made stated we would be doing church functions, but no one allowed for church functions, not after 5 p.m. Number three, no garden tour or small event. The same day we have a wedding. Most weddings start 3 or 4 o'clock in the afternoon. The family out of town wanting to tour the garden, we will have to turn them away. Number four, only 4 employees are allowed to operate and maintain the 10-acre high maintenance garden.
Excuse me, sir. Your time is up. Can you wrap it up?
Okay, real soon. My wife and I will have to, in our retiring years, we'll have to start working 24 hours a day to get all the work done. We're also restricted in our religious exercise by being banned from speaking with amplified sound. Elderly people need the sound system. Number six, black on white, it says no music allowed for small events. No radio singing or playing my pan flute on my own property. We have a wealth of history on our property that should be preserved. Glen Echo Coal Mine, the Gooding Lumber and Shingle Mill.
Thank you.
I do wish that we can have a turning point and that we may be able to work with the council to get some of these issues resolved. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Carol Slesnick, and thank you for the opportunity to speak. I'm talking about the jail, and in my opinion, the need for a jail is an indication of failure on many, many levels. I think that Whatcom County can do better for the children of today who would become tomorrow's incarcerated adults. I urge the council to consider plans that will speak to these challenges, identifying at-risk youth, implementing successful programs to counter the negative forces in the people's lives, and funding the programs that have been proven to work, and those can be found everywhere. Let's plan for a future where we have less need for almost $100 million jail. Let us be the county that stops punishing the victims. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Arlene Feld. I'm a clinician for the crisis triage program. I've been working for them for 8 years, and my work there has made me into a mental health activist. I have learned what it takes to treat this population. I see the complexity, the layers of problems that they have, homelessness, addiction, and mental health problems. So I want to ask you, when you make this jail, to include in this jail a well-developed, well-budgeted program for treatment. I would like to see them not come back so soon. I'd like to see them not come back so much to us. And we have to start filling in the holes of the treatment system. And the jail and the prison is going to be one really important place. Now, I understand that we cannot use the money that is for the jail construction, but I want to ask you to really think hard and use all the brilliant minds that we have in this county to come up with a way to finance what you need, because it's vital. And now is the point at which to do it. It's not sufficient to just have that. We also have to have a triage program within our city to treat other people who are not necessarily headed for jail, but very much in need. We don't have enough beds. We don't have enough treaters. We don't have enough space. So we're asking you to do that too. I think that diversion is a very valuable idea. I don't know that it's fully developed and tested out, but I think it should be. And so some of this process could be treated, and there could be improvement in terms of coming back to jail by using diversion. But we also have to have thorough treatment from top to bottom. So it isn't enough that when people are treated, they leave and go home. They have to have transition to home. They have to have transitional places to stay. And we have to provide for homeless people. Now, I know you think that this is a big budgetary issue, and it is. But I'm saying it anyway because it absolutely is essential. People without a place to live can't get their meds, can't get to their appointments, can't get their mail.
30 seconds, please.
So it's important. So when you look at these problems, please look at them from the point of view that you are working on a social service issue. And all the things you're doing are connected. And when you're thinking about it, please consider that too. So give us really good treatment for mental health and addiction in several places. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I'm Cassandra Childs from Bridget Collins. I'm a volunteer for the Bridget Collins Public Policy Education Committee, and our purpose is to improve the safety and well-being of children by educating policymakers on issues pertinent to children and families and the best practices for serving them. That is why I am here today. The Council has been discussing proposals to build a new jail and create a Whatcom County Criminal Justice Diversion Task Force, and we want to encourage you to routinely ask yourselves, how does this decision improve the lives of children in Whatcom County? With that in mind, we respectfully ask you to consider these three things. What do children think of the issues being addressed? Does this proposal keep children safe? And what opportunities does this proposal create for children? Parental incarceration is recognized as an adverse childhood experience because of the unique combination of trauma, shame, and stigma that it creates. When their parent can't come home, a child is often filled with difficult emotions and questions that their support systems have trouble answering. Disruption and instability in the home, combined with social stigma and shaming from peers, can result in trust issues, social skill development problems, anxiety, fear, and can lead to serious mental and physical health problems later in life. What can help? According to studies on the subject, frequent visits with parents in most cases help the child heal from their sudden and painful loss and are critical to the child's overall well-being. An estimated 50 to 70% of jail inmates are parents. Providing educational opportunities on how they can protect and maintain a positive relationship with their child during and after their release could help to reduce the effects of trauma and social stigma on a child. The Bridget Collins Public Policy Education Committee has two recommendations for your consideration. Support and treatment to reduce the traumatic impact of arrest and incarceration on the child should be available to children at the time of arrest and during incarceration. Offer incarcerated parents brief parenting skills, building sessions daily, and parenting-focused, therapeutically enhanced family visits when necessary. Changing the community conversation about jail from one of punishment and shame to one of safety and opportunity may help children, families, and incarcerated parents learn and become motivated to be a healthy and productive family. Thank you for listening. You have a copy of our testimony, and you feel free to contact us at Bridget Collins if you have any questions.
Thank you.
Lisa McShane, 1451 Grant Street. First, I'm speaking for myself tonight, and I support a new jail. A few years ago, I served as the vice chair of the jail planning task force. And while on the jail planning task force, we were told that the average cost per bed to build a new jail is around $80,000. We were shown the SCORE jail. I just passed out the information about that. As a great example of what we should be building, people went and visited it. It seemed like a good jail. It was built in South King County in 2011 for under $70,000 per bed. So the Whatcom County Jail, as proposed, is $186,000 per bed. That's more than twice the national average just 3 years ago. So I was wondering what the national average is today. Have building costs really doubled since 2011? So I spent some late nights researching current jail projects around the United States. That's what that spreadsheet is. It's Google, Bing, and I, the jails I found, I plugged in the number of beds, the cost of the project. Some of the projects included other things like sheriff's offices, but I had no way of removing those. Those are still in there. I only found one jail currently being built in the entire United States that's more expensive per bed than ours. That's in Santa Barbara, California. The national average is around $100,000 per bed. So if we follow that national average, that's the current national average, our price would be about $52 million, not $97 million. So I'm not sure why it's so expensive, but it seems like something's not right. But I want to go back to that SCORE jail. You may hear that our jail costs an additional $40 million because we need to build a big kitchen and laundry room to accommodate phase two. Phase two, the sheriff can correct me if I'm wrong, but I think it's between 800 and 900 beds total. The SCORE jail has 804 beds plus 29 medical beds, and they built a kitchen and facilities for that size, all for $56 million. Why is ours 300 beds smaller and $40 million more? I'm here today to say we cannot be the county that builds the second most expensive jail currently in the United States. Our county needs a new jail. But that should not be misconstrued as a blank check. We must be careful with taxpayer money. So I'm asking you to hold your vote until these questions are answered just for 2 weeks. I want you to know that community organizations have been meeting. We are looking to help the county and the city find a compromise that works for everybody, because I don't think you're on the same page. A compromise that will make us safer and ensure we get a new jail in a reasonable period of time. We do have time to get this right. We shouldn't be in a hurry to get this wrong.
Thank you.
Hi, Amy. Amy Kahn, Bellingham. I imagine it's tempting to approve the jail resolutions before you today. You could cross the jail issue off your list and send it to the voters. Please don't do it. These proposals will not keep us safe. They will burden the next generation with massive debt, and they will eliminate any criminal justice sales tax funding for the next 30 years. There are still too many unanswered questions. Will the city of Bellingham support the agreement as currently written? What other options for cost sharing and savings might bring them on board? It's illogical to send this measure to the voters without the city's commitment. As 20% of the jail population, will the tribes be willing to pay the high projected per diems, or will they build a regional tribal facility at a lower annual cost to them? What federal and private grant money are we missing out on for lack of a grant writer? Spokane is in line to receive $2 million annually from the MacArthur Foundation for their jail re-envisioning. Why didn't we apply for that money? Why are we budgeting for a 50-year jail when the current jail was obsolete within 10 years? Are we so much more prescient now, or did trends and technology change in unforeseeable ways, just as will likely happen again? Where's the cost comparison you've requested for building and operating a Skagit-sized facility? Where does the extra money go if the county secures a bond rate lower than 5%? If we're serious about building a crisis center and saving millions of dollars through diversion, why isn't the construction money being officially allocated right now? NISMA is ready to provide operational costs for this more effective and more affordable alternative. These are just a few of the remaining and troubling questions. They are questions we will all have before November, And if you don't get us the answers now, we will be guessing later in the middle of a polarized campaign. Whatcom County needs a safer, better jail, but more than anything, we need a safe community. Mass incarceration of nonviolent pretrial people creates the opposite. It fuels more violence and disrespect for the law. Jail is the most expensive and least effective way to deal with violators. Diversion and alternatives cost a fraction of detention and have vastly greater impacts on reducing future criminal behavior. The jail task force and members of the community have asked you to think big. There is a talk tomorrow night by the ACLU that will be incredibly informative and relevant to this discussion. And as Lisa mentioned, a group of community organizations is currently writing a jail counterproposal, which should be presented to you in 2 weeks at the next council meeting. So I urge you to delay any vote for at least 2 weeks until this committee has finished crafting the document and until the city of Bellingham has made clear its position on the jail. Thank you.
Thank you.
Barbara Sternberger, Sternberger. I'm here tonight as an individual, not with a group, although I have served on the jail task force. I've been a member of RANA, the Rural Avenue Neighborhood Association, as well as Right Size Jail. I'm here tonight to urge you to ask Jack Lau one question. Why can't we do what was done at the DNL group at the South King County with the SCORE jail that you guys have in front of you? I get frustrated because we are in such need of a new jail and we don't move forward because of the cost, and I don't think if this goes to if this goes on the ballot this soon in this state, we're not going to get where we need to go, which is to get a new jail built, but one that is affordable, one that is the right size, and also in the right location, but that's another issue. So I'm here to urge you guys to really look at that handout that Lisa gave you, go to that website, see what's possible, and ask yourselves, why can't we do this and get this thing going? And the gal that was talking from Bridget Collins, my husband and I both volunteer at Bridget Collins as well, and the thing that is most frustrating for me to see is when I go to the jail and I see the incarcerated there, I think these conditions are not right. This county is a fabulous place to live. We have so much to be proud of, and yet this issue we just cannot get right. So I'm just really urging you guys to please postpone and let's get some figures that the community can back. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, Rebecca Johnson from Bellingham. And I'm here tonight also to encourage the council to postpone putting the jail initiative on the ballot. At least give us 2 weeks that we can provide you with some alternative options. I'm concerned about the cost of the jail and the size of the jail for our community. I'm worried that using our sales tax option to tie up funds for the next 30 years that could go to alternative programs and operations is a problem. I'd like to see us consider using some property taxes for the capital expenses of the jail, and so that we can save some of that sales tax revenue for programs and operations. Most importantly, there are smarter and more efficient ways to deal with crime, and using evidence-based practices, we can provide a safer community while also reducing recidivism in our jails. The number one predictor of someone reoffending is the number of days they've spent in jail, according to national studies. And I was in a community meeting today where we learned of some really exciting things that are happening in Spokane that I think we could consider for our community. And we would have alternatives to the larger jail that provides safety and, again, reduce recidivism. So I hope you will consider giving us some time to present some other options for you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Dan McShane, 1451 Grant Street, Bellingham. I wish I could really be articulate and tell you some brilliant thing that will solve all your problems regarding the jail and the criminal justice system. And there's too many things about this problem that I can touch on in 3 minutes, and I don't think I could even if you gave me 20, because it's so difficult and hard. Earlier speaker, I'll just riff off, said think big. Well, I think you need to think broadly. And unfortunately, this is the situation you're in politically, is that your job is to consider whether to send this to the taxpayers to approve. And so you're putting the responsibility on someone like me. I'm pretty engaged in terms of local issues. And my concern is that what we've got before us, you know, the community really hasn't been engaged in this. I know there's an effort always to engage the community, but the best people to engage the community and move that kind of ideas and vet all the different approaches that could be taken, the wide, broad approaches toward law and justice, are you guys. You can ask the prosecutor, the defense attorneys, the judges about different programs, what's effective. And so my fear is that many of those will be put aside. And I think it's a legitimate fear, because you did receive a letter from the prosecutor. And if you read through carefully on mental health commitments, he says, however, this has become very time-consuming for both the public defenders and my office. So does he have the support to do mental health commitments? The recession hit many of the initiatives implemented as part of the law and justice strategic plan, lost funding. They were defunded. Due to loss of funding, the alcohol and substance abuse treatment that had been available in the alternatives corrections was terminated. So those are really pretty recent things that harmed the system as a whole. And so I guess what I would like to ask you is, don't bow to the pressure right now. You've got to get the community behind this, because if the community's not behind it, someone like me, who actually believes that we need a new jail,
30 seconds, please,
will vote no, because I don't have the confidence that we will have an appropriate long-term criminal justice system appropriately funded, and that it will be a failure. And until you can convince someone like me, and you've got to convince a lot of us, I think it might be too early to move forward with this at this time.
Time.
So thank you. Good luck.
Hi, my name is Kirsten Barron. I'm an attorney in Bellingham. I live down at Lake Sammish, and I am here in my volunteer capacity. So I have spent the last 20 years in Whatcom County working on access to justice. How do we get folks who are poor or who otherwise face barriers into the court system? And as part of that work over 20 years, obviously our populations cross, the civil client and the criminal client. So even though I'm not in the civil or in the criminal arena, I keep a close eye on it because it affects our clients. And here's what's been really interesting to me. In the last 2 years, what is happening in criminal justice has changed enormously. There has been an incredible sea change. Every time I turn around, there's another report from DOJ. There's another, you know, study out talking about what's effective and what's not. I feel like we are on the cusp of big changes in criminal justice. I don't want to diminish, everybody thinks we need a jail. Folks have said a lot of great things tonight, I'm not going to repeat them. I guess my comment is, I'll be candid, I don't want just 2 weeks. I would like the council to take a year and to figure out, okay, where is criminal justice going? What is happening the next 30 years? Because I think so much has changed the last 18 months or 24 months. I just get worried that we're building a jail for the last 30 years and not the next 30 years. So I would encourage the council just to step back, because there is so much new information. And by the way, thanks for extending your time and letting us all talk. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name's Mary Locum, and I'm just here to weigh in and reiterate a lot of what you've heard tonight, postponement, reconsideration, greater investigation of size and cost, and a greater consideration of alternatives to justice. I'm the manager of a community farm here in Bellingham, York Community Farm, and we have a resume building internship program, and we're servicing underserved members of our community, veterans, homeless, and reentry folks. And the changes that we've seen in folks coming in and just going through a three-month internship program at our farm are remarkable. If that's, I mean, it's not scientifically proven or anything, but that kind of experience has got to be a lot better than putting someone in jail. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Brian Beggs, former resident of this county, but I currently live in Spokane. I'm a lawyer. I mostly represent crime victims. And I was in town on business, and some friends encouraged me to talk with you about what's going on in Spokane, because we have the same problem with you. We have a jail about the same size. It's crumbling. It's overcrowded. And we have taken a different approach. We had on the agenda over $300 million jail. And the city and the county have come together, and they've really put together a planning process of not just the top elected officials, but everyone, every department, to figure out what would make our community safer, what will actually reduce crime. And the current jail proposal is about $100 million, so it's a third of what the original was. We're still not done yet, because we're focusing on evidence-based practices. And if you're interested on what reduces crime, you can go to the Washington State Institute of Public Policy. They have all the studies. And it turns out that jail is the most expensive intervention, but it actually leads to more recidivism. Some people are very violent, need to be in jail. A lot of people are just nonviolent, waiting for a hearing. I would encourage you, before you bet the next 30 years of all available sales tax revenues for criminal justice, on this strategy, to take a year and duplicate what Spokane has done, which is much more law and order, much stingier on taxes than we are here in Whatcom, and figure out what will work and what will protect the community, and keep your options open. You can reduce the jail population without community safety issues by going to electronic home monitoring pretrial, by diverting driving while license suspended in the third degree, by expanding court hours with flexing schedules of existing staff, so that you can reduce the population in the jail now of nonviolent people, so that you can extend that jail a little bit longer, get a plan that will work. If we can do it in Spokane, I know you can do it in Whatcom, because you guys are really on top of it. So thanks for your time, and good luck.
Thank you.
Patrick Ellis, 4825 Alderson Road. I'm glad that fella got a little humor in there. I usually do, and I was thinking, maybe not this time. It's my uncle's retirement watch, Reese Cummings. He was a prison guard at Attica State. One thing I learned from Uncle Reese was there's people who are in jail who just want to be someplace secure. And maybe we need to figure out how to supply that for them. Now, I'm going to sound a little crass here. For the price of two beds, you can buy a couple acres on Terrell Lake or Terrell Creek Spit and a parking lot near restrooms that actually function. Now, I'll put this over here. You can read them later. The interesting thing is, I've been talking to a young man who spent some time in the jail here. Yes, it does need to be redone. He goes down to the beach with his wife, and they spend time talking about things they're trying to do, jobs he hopes he get. I've talked to him for three times over the last 3 weeks. What does he want from me? A little sense of, yes, you're doing the right thing. Yes, you're going in the right direction. So listen, you guys, give him some more beach room, just two beds worth. But seriously, we need to do something about the jail. I think Bill is flexible, and good luck with all this. Oh, I'll leave this here. I'm serious about this, too.
Thank you.
Hi.
My name is Chris Phillips. I live in the Geneva area, and I work at Peace Health. And it's easy in these days of partisanship.
For you to say.
Yeah, it is. To get cynical about government. But I believe the conversations that have unfolded over the last several months and perhaps will continue to unfold really say a lot about what's good about government and what's good about our community. In particular, asking the question what we can do to increase diversion and treatment programs to serve people who have mental illness and substance abuse problems is an expression of what is good about our community. On behalf of Peace Health, I want to express appreciation to you and the council for the leadership that you're showing to frame the issue so that we can address the very real need for a new jail. No one is questioning that, while at the same time planning for how it can be used most effectively. I also want to express appreciation to the county council, to the county executive, and to the sheriff for their leadership in helping us stay focused on making progress towards a new jail. They've showed flexibility in accommodating the need for diversion and treatment programs. The end result, I hope, is that we will have a real financial commitment to pursue diversion treatment programs, which will make perhaps approval of the jail that much easier. Let me close with two quick quotes. The first is from Newt Gingrich. There's an urgent need to address the astronomical growth in the prison population with its huge costs in dollars and lost human potential. I remind you, this is Newt Gingrich. We can no longer afford business as usual with prisons. The criminal justice system is broken, and conservatives must lead the way. The last quote is from Hubert Humphrey. He said, the moral test of government is how that government treats those who are in the dawn of life. Children, those who are in the twilight of life, elderly, and those who are in the shadows of life, the sick, the needy, and the handicapped. I want to thank the council and the exec for being on the right side of history as it relates to the criminal justice issues before you. And also, I want to simply thank you for doing the right thing, for ensuring that we take care of those in the shadows the best that we can. Thank you.
Thank you.
Greg Brown, Whatcom County. We need a jail. We need it now. We needed it 20 years ago. We found excuses 20 years ago. Maybe it was waiting to get the numbers up on Railroad Avenue. Maybe it was waiting for the price of berries to go up. I have no idea. And I don't know what, if we wait another year, what more excuses will come up for putting it off. I'm really troubled in the fact that for the last year or better, you guys have had five meetings with the DL group who designed this. The executive has made presentations three or four times about the cost and size. We had a task force, many of who spoke tonight, having been on that task force, supported this jail and what we moved ahead with, and show up here this night to speak against it. Oh, but we're for it, but we're going to speak against it. Yet I don't remember them participating and listening to the DL group or offering this input as the jail was designed and put together. So I think this will go on forever if we continue to let this move on. We need to build a jail. We need a jail. You know, you're already addressing the roadblock with the triage. You're working on that. You're working a task force. Issue addressed. Let it happen. We need a jail. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Irene Morgan. I'm founder of the Restorative Community Coalition 8 years ago. It's been said that I don't play well with others. At first, I took exception to this, but upon contemplation, I realized I don't play well with others when I see unfairness or injustice. I see unfairness and injustice with the new jail proposal. Who designated the $18.5 million specifically for the sheriff's headquarters? Who says $18.5 million should go there? They're public funds. Can't we use them for other uses? And are those other uses not being considered? How far would $18 million go for services to reduce the jail population in this time of overcrowding and crisis? I've not asked this question before. Could it be that the numbers of legally innocent are kept high, large bail amounts, that drug court is at less than half capacity, and good time cut in half to artificially keep our jail bed stays high to make it look like we need a larger jail when we truly don't? In my opinion, that's what it looks like to me from the research we've done. Why? Why would we do that? To maintain the status quo? Let's stop wasting tax dollars now. I urge you to please vote no on the proposed jail and the new tax initiative. A portion of this tax is never ending, will go on into perpetuity. And portions are not designated for what the monies are used for. There's better use of tax dollars. You've heard lots of people talk in that manner this evening. Prevention and early intervention, early childhood education, restorative justice, better mental health programs are much better use of the monies from my perspective. And our Canadian shoppers are fickle with the fluctuation of their tax dollars for the tax base that is expected to flow. And the tax base of middle America is shrinking. This is unsustainable from my view. The operations, as quoted by our executive, the operations will be $3 billion in 30 years. Other new jails across the country are empty or not filled to capacity. We have existing buildings and areas suitable for many alternatives, as we have shared in our presentation earlier. A no vote is a vote for right action for all our citizens, and I encourage you to vote no on this proposal as it stands. And we, the coalition, are doing a conference
30 seconds, please.
On June 30 at Garden Street Methodist Church in the Fireside Room. We're going to share our views on reclaiming lives. The title is Reclaiming Lives and Restoring Community, and there'll be morning and afternoon sessions, and we invite the community to attend. Thank you so much.
Thank you. If there's anybody else after Joy speaks, come on down.
My name is Joy Gilfillan. I'm the president of the Restorative Community Coalition. And we've been working and doing research through the coalition. Irene started in 2006. I joined her about 5 years ago. And I put my business on hold so that I could do the research into why our economy was so upside down and why the prison industrial economy was driving our business model for the nation. And it's taken us a long time to figure out how to speak about this in a way that could get us out of the emotionalism of all the trauma and all the social justice conversation. But what we've figured out is that the jail industrial complex has actually reached its zenith as an economic model in the nation and must turn over. This is the sea change that the lady in front of me is talking about. We are spending enormous amounts of tax dollars on incarceration for a negative return on investment. It's time to turn that conversation over. We've created for the coalition alone, we've been here before talking about how we need to do intervention treatment, how we need to do social services, how we need to help. We presented to you in a nine-step process for how we could actually reverse the situation from a nonprofit standpoint, from a governmental standpoint. But now we have five business models that could come to market that are each designed to be self-reliance-based in a few years. We need a little bit of startup capital. We are going to launch a fundraising campaign in Whatcom County to actually launch a $5 million campaign that could actually return hundreds of millions of dollars to this community, because it's about building jobs. It's about putting people to work, not into jail. This is the new restorative economy. If you actually look at the costs that will accrue if we pass another 0.02% sales tax, we've already got roughly 3% going into emergency management, mental health, and incarceration systems. You add another 0.02%, that's almost 5.05%. That's a massive amount of money. That's hundreds of million. I mean, that's millions a year, billions over the lifetime of this investment. That is a major capital cost to the taxpayers, and no one has done a fiscal accountability assessment to the taxpayers. No one has looked at the cost of poverty and what it would cost to actually do a major sea change in Whatcom County. I think we are in a position to be able to change the future in Whatcom County. And I think that it is only responsible to postpone the sales tax initiative, to proceed with your task force, but go in with the intention of removing 30% of the people from the system to start with, and then figure out where you can build a jail that's right-sized and appropriate for the community. Thank you for your consideration. Really quick, this is the amount of materials that we have delivered to the County Council through the EIS, the SDEIS, through the various submissions over time. And it is a bit shaming to our executive branch and our government systems that we have not been answered in many of the questions and concerns we've brought forward. I think that's really shameful for a nonprofit organization that has volunteered all of our time to have to compete with millions of dollars that have been spent to build a jail, but that has not been spent to look at restorative economics and alternatives that are better return on investment to the taxpayers. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is interesting, unexpected experience Saturday afternoon. I talked with a fairly good acquaintance who was released from the Whatcom County Jail about 4 or 5 months ago. Previous to that, he spent 3.5 years in state prison. Previous to that, some years, or before being sent to prison, he was incarcerated here, sent to prison, came back, was incarcerated here until released into the community. Some years prior to that, when he was younger, he was also incarcerated. I didn't know him then. I don't know for how long. I will never forget what he said to me on Saturday. We talked for 2.5 hours. I don't remember a thing he said, but I'll never forget this. He said, if I ever have to be incarcerated again, he says, I pray I don't have to go to the Whatcom County Jail. He says, I would much rather go straight to prison. He says, the Whatcom County Jail, and I won't use some of the adjectives he said, and he wasn't saying it in defiance or anger. He's an intellectual guy, and he says, I cannot believe that facility and what has happened to it. He'd rather go straight to prison than our county jail. Thank you for your service. All the meetings you folks must hear and listen to, it takes a great deal of endurance, dedication. The words I hear tonight of let's postpone this, the words I hear of let's put this off, I've been hearing this for 20 years. How much longer do we need? I've heard the terms, instead of thinking big, let's think, you know, realistically. I'm saying, well, that's a good thought, but let's also think the realities. Quite frankly, personal opinion, I don't think this is the time to talk about voting on the jail. Councils in the past couldn't or wouldn't make a decision. The project has been mismanaged and the can kicked down the road far enough.
30 seconds, please.
Professional jail planners, jail engineers who performed their educated assessments. It's time to stop talking. It's time to act. It's time to act. Let's move forward. Let's not talk about it any longer. Let's let the voters have the opportunity to say yes or no. I'm having people ask me, why is the council putting this off? I'm ready to vote. I don't have a good answer for them. If you can't decide to do now, time. Let's let the voters decide as soon as possible. I would ask you, let's make a difference tonight. Tonight. How much longer do we need to put it down the road?
Thank you.
Good evening. Ray Baribeau, B-A-R-I-B-E-A-U, Bellingham. And, of course, you've heard me before. I want to address a couple things I heard tonight. First of all, the wonderful woman that spoke from Bridget Collins about parenting for children. And I remember our chief, Wendy Jones, said that one of the things she would like to do in a new jail is have parenting classes and anger management classes and things that will benefit the inmates and their families. That's one reason why we need a new jail yesterday, to have the facilities to put on the programs that our leaders in the incarceration or correction system would like to offer these people. Another thing I heard was the comparison of the bed cost of our proposed facility to what it costs to build SCORE. And Penny, the woman that drove that program and is the chief operation officer of SCORE, told us when she visited, they got a sweetheart deal. They were able to get their contract out for construction right at the bottom of the construction industry. So any comparison to the costs that we might be faced to what they did at SCORE is too bad, Whatcom County. We're several days late, and we're going to be several dollars greater than what it costs to build SCORE. That's reality. Timing is everything, and if we didn't have bad timing, we wouldn't have any timing at all. The other thing I'd like to say is that there were plenty of public meetings. I don't know how many I've been to, but I'll tell you one I went to a week ago this past Wednesday, and only one county council member was there. God bless you, Barbara Brenner and Rosie. And that was NAMI, National Association for Mental Illness, put on a forum on mental illness in the criminal justice system. Only one county council member was there. It was an awesome forum. Wendy Jones spoke, and Deacon kicked it off from the public health point of view, and she told her story about running the Special Offenders Unit in Monroe, which is where the dangerously mentally ill offenders are held. Her background's awesome. We are grateful to have her in our county.
30 seconds, please.
Wendy then told her story about how she got interested and involved with mental illness, and she's passionate about it to this day. And Commissioner Pete Smiley from Bellingham Municipal Jail or Municipal Court then described how mental health court works. And then Ann got up again to cover for a co-worker and talk about all the different programs that we have that they want to expand. We're in good shape. We just need to keep the ball rolling forward. You've got one ordinance and two proposals to vote on tonight. Please vote yes and keep it moving. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Bob Frisk. I'm a volunteer chaplain for the Whatcom County Sheriff's Office. And I would ask you to vote for the jail tonight, literally to remember the guys right behind us that are working in that hellhole, that thing that we call a jail. It's horrible. It's a horrible work conditions. Most of you have been there. You've had tours. You know what it's like. We need to do something. We need to do it now. You can't wait a year. If that place catches on fire, we're going to get a lawsuit that will, you know, the act of God wouldn't even protect us from. It's a civil rights violation, and I'm just asking you to vote for it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Chris Alterman, Whatcom County. I'm here to urge you, to beg you, to please move the jail forward. I want you to think about yourself, your husband, your wife, your parents, your kids, your grandkids, your loved ones, if they were ever to be placed into that jail, how would you feel? Think about it. Realistically, stand in their shoes. Stand in the shoes of the people who are working there every day. And the fact that this should have been taken care of years ago, the public has asked you and given you permission to do it. It's your responsibility to move it forward. So please do so tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. If there's anybody else, there's going to be an opportunity right after the speaker.
Hi, my name is Teresa Erickson of Bellingham, Washington, and you've seen my face here before, so you know what I'm going to ask you to do tonight. I stand with those who say please vote yes on these resolutions tonight. I hear all the information coming tonight, and I have to confess of being discouraged at the thought of putting off this process for even yet one more year. 10 years ago, the council had an opportunity to move it forward, and it got stopped dead in its tracks. So I want to know what's happened in the last 10 years that the questions that are coming up tonight, why haven't these been answered now, even by now? Clearly, we have an opportunity, you know, the criminal justice system is evolving. It's going to continue to evolve. And if we stop the process of a new building to get all of the answers to solve all of our social issues, we're never going to get a jail. And that is the bottom line for this situation, is we have a dangerous situation for everybody. The people who work there, who serve a voluntary life sentence because they work there, because that's what they've committed to do to keep us safe. There are people who are incarcerated there. They're in danger. You know, and as a community, we hold that responsibility because, as the pastor just said, if there's any kind of serious loss of life or injury based on a known safety violation, as a community, we hold the responsibility of paying for any kind of lawsuit. So, yes, there are questions that need to be answered. I'm encouraging you to get those answers, but I'm asking you, I'm begging you, please don't let this process get stopped yet again. We need to keep it moving forward. Please move it forward and get those questions answered while we still go in a forward direction. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else?
Doralee Booth, Birch Bay. I served on the jail planning task force 3 years ago, and I must say I'm perplexed. I kind of wonder what was going on these last 3 years. I know we were making progress in the location and the design and all of the jail, but it seems like at the last minute, when decisions have to be made to roll the ball forward, people come out of the woodwork, and it seems to once again slow us down. The jail planning task force recommended to the county in April 2012 a recommendation that still stands today. We encourage the Whatcom County Council to move forward on a new jail, it stated. The task force agreed that in order to provide safe and cost-effective criminal justice solutions for our community, we urgently need a new safe jail, efficient, humane, safe jail, and improvements to programming and alternatives to incarceration. And when I first started serving on this, I wondered, Pete, why in the world you asked me to serve. You said I was smart. Well, I wasn't really smart on these kinds of things, but I did learn, I listened, and I learned that this is a very complicated issue. It's expensive, it's political, and it's fraught with misconceptions. But I believe working together, we can replace the failing jail and develop more behavioral and mental health programming at the same time, following the 2012 Jail Planning Task Force recommendation. I want to tell you, I have two sons working in Skagit County. One is a lieutenant with the PD, and the other one is a plans examiner and a building inspector, and he is working on the plans for the new Skagit County Jail. He told me that the jail is for 400 beds with a capacity for 800 beds. Skagit County's population is 120,365 in 2014. We're looking at a jail of 521 beds with a capacity to expand to 642. Whatcom County's 2014 population is 208,351. What do they know that we don't know? I believe Whatcom County is going to continue to grow and probably faster than Skagit County. He said their laundry
30 seconds,
and their
please.
Kitchen facilities are huge, medical, dental facilities, mental health and behavioral facilities. We need to get moving and get this done.
Thank you. Anybody else want to address us during open session? Seeing no one, I'm going to close the open session. We're going to move on to our regular business. First up is the consent agenda from the Finance Committee. And before we start on that, I got a note from our clerk that Mr. Brown is right. We don't need seconds. If anybody hears us talking about seconds, this is the first night in years that the council has changed their operating procedure. We used to not require seconds to move motions forward. At our last meeting, we changed that procedure. So this evening, we will be requiring seconds. But the clerk informed me that something coming as a recommendation from a committee does not need a second.
Mr. Chairman, the Whatcom County Council Finance Administrative Services Committee met this morning, and there were five items on the consent agenda, all of which met with approval for 3-0, and I so move.
All right, we have that motion from Mr. Brown in front of us. Any discussion on any of those? Ms. Brenner.
Please remove number 5.
All right, we're going to pull number 5. Any other discussion? Mr. Brown.
Mr. Chair, I just, for the record, I think it would be good for us to move number 1 for a separate vote.
Poll number 1 also, so we're going to vote on 2, 3, and 4.
1 came forward.
Mr. Brown just asked that it be a separate vote. All right, so we're voting on the consent agenda items 2, 3, and 4. Any other discussion? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Okay, number 1.
So, Mr. Chair, I wanted to read this one into the record. Number 1 is a resolution in support of the National Stepping Up Initiative designed to reduce the number of people with mental illness in jail. That was approved 3-0, and I so move.
All right, so we have that motion in front of us. That's the National Association of Counties initiative for keeping mental health folks out of jail. Any other discussion? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? That passes unanimously. Number 5.
And Mr. Chair, number 5 is request approval for the county executive to award bid 15-44, accepting all bids for the annual supply of rock, gravel, and soil for uses needed for various county maintenance projects and select the appropriate vendor as dictated by special circumstances of each particular job in an amount to exceed $50,000. This was met and voted on 3-0, and I so move.
All right, we have that motion in front of us. Ms. Brenner.
Yeah, I just am uncomfortable with exceed. We put the $50,000 in there for a reason. I'm very uncomfortable with increasing the executive's unilateral authority to spend money without bringing it to the council. And I was not very impressed with not only the reason, because if something is really urgent, he can do it either as an emergency or request us to have a special meeting. Other than that, it also, we never got the number of how much money is in that budget. I specifically asked how much is, and it looks like we're going to get that now, but I'm not comfortable giving away more of the council's authority.
John Hutchings, Public Works. Over the past 3 years, Public Works has spent on the order of an average of $250,000 a year, closer to $200,000 in 12 and 13, and $250,000 in 14. And that is in 2014 over the course of about 251 purchase orders. And if you do the math, that works out to an average of about $1,000 a purchase order. So the bottom line is that the utility of being able to go out under a pre-approved contract to obtain these resources, which don't equate to an emergency action by the county, gives us the ability, the flexibility to be able to complete the roadworks and similar operational needs over the course of a year. And we recognize that that there are certain instances in which the exceedance of the $50,000 council-approved limit is it's going to happen in the operational world we live in. So we come, use the bid process to identify those vendors that we can draw on, have that open conversation with you all before we start the year out on the roads and go from there.
Ms. Brenner.
Well, nothing would please me more than to be able to agree with Dr. Hutchings, but what's been happening in the past? Okay, we didn't have this ability, so what happened?
We had this ability in the past.
Well, so this is a renewal of increasing the limit?
No, we're not increasing the limit. We come back every year and recognize that we will very likely, almost certainly, spend more than the $50,000 limit on acquiring aggregates for our maintenance work.
Well, I'm not asking the question you're answering. Why put this in here at all if it's already happening?
That was from last year's authority.
So it has to be renewed every year?
Yeah, so we come back to you every year and demonstrate to you that that we're going to, over the course of the summer period, be using this material in excess of the council approval amount.
Okay, so if we do this now, this only covers this summer?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Thank you for understanding.
All right, any other discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That was easy.
Well, it was better explained than it was today in committee, that's for sure. Yeah.
All right, we're on to other items from finance.
Mr. Chair, the committee met and debated item number one, which is an ordinance authorizing an interfund loan to continue financing for the Central Plaza building. This was discussed in committee and was approved with a vote of 3-0, and I so move.
All right, we have that motion in front of us. Any discussion? Seeing none, we're ready for the roll call.
Barbara Brenner?
Yes.
Rud Browne?
Yes.
Barry Buchanan?
Yes.
Pete Kremen?
Yes.
Ken Mann?
Yes.
Satpal Sidhu?
Yes.
Carl Weimer?
Yes. That passes unanimously. We're on to the second item.
No, Mr. Chair, the next item was an ordinance authorizing an interfund loan to continue financing the assessor-treasurer system. This also received a vote of 3-0, and I so move.
All right, we have that motion in front of us. Any discussion? Seeing none, we're ready for the roll call.
Rud Browne?
Yes.
Barry Buchanan?
Yes.
Pete Kremen?
Yes.
Ken Mann?
Yes.
Satpal Sidhu?
Yes.
Carl Weimer?
Yes.
Barbara Brenner?
Yes.
That passes unanimously.
Mr. Chair, the next item was local solicitation for council review and public comment on the Edward Byrne Memorial Justice Assistance Grant Program. This also received a vote of 3-0, and I so move.
All right, we have that motion in front of us. Any discussion? Ms. Brenner?
Well, just because some stuff similar was brought up tonight, it says Justice Assistance Grant, could this money be used for diversion services? Anybody know? If the county or a nonprofit gets funding from this, could it be used for that?
Yes, it's eligible for that also. We requested the purchase of ballistic vests in accordance with the council's direction at the budget preparation workshop to make full use of grants. It's something we're obligated to provide, and it was eligible under this grant, and that's why we applied for it.
Okay.
Any other discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That passes unanimously.